Good morning, friends. Welcome, welcome, welcome back to the conversation. We get a chance to do what not too many people get a chance to do, is pick the brain of one of the smartest guys in the Congress, Dr. Ron Paul, Congressman Ron Paul. He's from Texas. He was a presidential candidate, and he's on our newsmaker line right now. Good morning, Dr. Paul. How you doing, sir?
Good morning, Jan. How are you?
I'm doing great. It is great. A wonderful opportunity to get a chance to talk with you.
Oh, well, thank you.
I had an opportunity to have a conversation a couple of days ago, and then yesterday, too, about the issue of money in its nature and what we've done to debase it. And it got us involved into a constitutional issue. And I have a couple of constitutional questions for you, if you don't mind.
I'll give it a try.
Because I know that you've just written about the Federal Reserve, and you'd like to abolish the Federal Reserve.
Right.
And the reason for that is because it's engaging in fractional reserve banking without any real gold backing. They're just basically printing money. It's not even a constitutional banking system, is it?
No, because there's no authorization for a central bank. But interestingly enough, this argument started very early because Jefferson believed that there was no authority, and he got rid of the first national bank, and yet Hamilton loved it, and he wanted it, and said, oh, yes, we do. And then when it went to the courts, the court said, oh, yeah, it's an implied power. You know, we can do this. Of course, those kind of arguments have gone on throughout our history, but unfortunately, the courts have always ruled in favor of a central bank.
I guess that all takes us right back to the another issue about the judicial supremacy. Can the Supreme Court or any other court rewrite the Constitution to make it mean something that is explicitly denied by the Constitution itself?
Well, unfortunately, they've been doing it. It's getting worse all the time, and that has been the failure of our system and the shortcomings of the Constitution.
Yes.
You might also argue it's the shortcoming of the people who didn't have any desire to be bound down by the chains of the Constitution, and therefore we have endless growth of the government. Just think of what's been happening in the past 6 months. Nobody even thinks about the idea of whether or not what we're doing in Congress or with the Federal Reserve or with Treasury is actually constitutional.
Well, here's a couple of the codicils in the Constitution under Section 8, and it has, this is the enumerated powers, which you guys are the list of powers you guys have. And one of them is to coin the money and regulate the value thereof. Now, coining is different than printing. Coining implies something of intrinsic worth, and the dollar at one time, in fact, it began in the 1700s, to be defined as according to gold content. It had to have so much in order to be considered a dollar.
That, of course, during that time when they were writing that, they talked about emitting bills of credit, which was paper money, and there's a prohibition against that.
Yeah, Section 10 says no state shall enter into a treaty or alliance or confederation. They can't grant letters of marque and reprisal or coin money or emit bills of credit. But here's the question I had for you. Or make anything but gold and silver coin a tender in payment of debts. That means that it has to be real money. The state has no ability to require us to pay anything that isn't gold or silver. Is that correct?
That's absolutely right. So there's the grand contradiction. The federal Constitution dictates rarely to the states, but it said you can't do anything, you can't use anything other than gold and silver. But then the federal government comes in and said, now you must use Federal Reserve notes as the only thing is legal tender.
Yes.
And, of course, then they wonder why the founders cared about this. Yeah, they understood about runaway inflation.
They had been a victim of it several times.
Yeah, then we wonder why we get into a mess, because even though we feel like, even those of us who are studying free market economics and the advancement of Austrian economics, the founders were pretty sound on this issue, because inflation, the destruction of currency, that's been something that's been known for thousands of years. All great empires end with the destruction of a currency.
Plus, they were just fresh from the experience of what happened to their own continental dollar.
Right.
And the British apparently had caught on to the paper money, and they were counterfeiting our continental dollar. And the British understood how to do it. And the British, in essence, counterfeited the American currency out of existence. And doggone it, the American public. Right now, the Federal Reserve is doing exactly the same thing the British did to us.
Yeah, we don't even need an enemy to do it. We do it to ourselves. And we've been getting away with it, you know, literally for especially these last 35 years. And everybody trusts us so well, and our great wealth and our military power, they take it. They take our money. But now I think soon at least they're going to realize that it is counterfeit money.
Yes.
And those dollars are all still exist, and they will come back home to roost here, which means that we're still in for a lot of trouble and a lot more inflation.
Almost $1 trillion in the stimulus package, and all of that's borrowed money. Isn't that correct, Congressman Paul?
It will be, because we have no money in the bank. They might not borrow it all, but they'll indirectly, you know, borrow from the future by just printing the money. So it's a form of borrowing. But there will I think right now even liberal Democrats are realizing that pouring on high taxes on an economy that has no income doesn't make a whole lot of sense.
Yeah.
So they're not going to. I don't think they are going to dump a lot of more taxes on us.
Yeah.
If anything, they might even lower taxes, but they will not stop spending, and they will not stop borrowing, they will not stop printing.
Well, I was thinking about this as we were promised. In fact, Senator Harkin was bragging that of that stimulus package, $1.5 billion is directed towards Iowa, and they're calling it a stimulus package. And I went through the list of things that are on that list that Iowa would directly get. Almost all of it goes to some welfare program or another. Almost every single penny. There wasn't a single penny that goes to the private sector, that goes to wealth production. All of it is consumption, and all of it goes to one form or another of welfare.
Well, and it's actually a negative, because in real terms, that has to come from somebody who could have been productive. Even if they didn't take it through taxation, they take it indirectly through the dilution factor of the money. So if there is real wealth transferred, and it's transferred from those who could have produced or invested and made proper decisions, given to individuals where the money is just spent and consumed.
Senator, and now President Obama says, you might be right. All these things might be correct, and your arguments are maybe even sound, and thank you for making them, but I won. And now I get to do what I want to do.
That reminds me of somebody saying something like that in the previous administration, where he says, I have political capital now, and I can do this and that.
Yes.
It is this arrogance that in the executive branch, which the Congress unfortunately has contributed to it, because they allow so much power to gravitate, that this is why we hear of these attitudes. Rather than saying, well, you know, the real democratic process is in the marketplace, where people spend their own money and they have the incentive to earn their own money, and the government's there to provide, you know, a healthy environment and sound money. So
what are we out here? What are we supposed to do, Congressman Paul? Are we hosed? Is this inevitable? Is there any political pressure that's left to be? I mean, what kind of political capital this close to an election do the voters really have? I mean, the political class doesn't even face election even in your office for another 2 years, and then president's another 4 years, and the senator another 6 years. So what capital do we have to spend in order to say no to this stuff?
Well, we don't have any immediate capital to stop this train that's running down over us. But I do believe that we have some things on our side. I think we have truth on our side. And I think that in time, people are going to realize that something else has to happen, because this program that we're working with now is a continuation of what we've been doing. It's just on an accelerated train right now. And it's going to fail. And believe me, it is serious, because it is a question of the survival of our country. The one thing I can say with confidence, I think there are more and more people, Jan, that are thinking along our way than they did. And I know you've been talking about and interested in the money issue for a lot of years.
Yes.
But there's a lot. I mean, I can go to campuses now, and these young people are reading Murray Rothbard and understanding the money issue and sick of the Federal Reserve. And they know this, even though we're not, you know, in charge. It seems like the younger generation are becoming knowledgeable enough that maybe we can sort this out and build something new and much better, rather than capitulating to total tyranny, which is generally what happens. But it's going to be a tough fight.
Congressman Paul, thank you for joining us briefly this morning.
Thank you very much.
You betcha. Bye-bye. It is 17 after 10. Michelson here with you. I know that's quickie. I'm going to check in with him. I think we almost have a relationship now that we can get him for a handful of minutes once a month. That's Ross, my producer, arranged that, so we have him on the list. What? And plus, the Campaign for Liberty helped out with that. And as long as we can do that, we will. I think we're going to talk with a general here in a sec.